Happy Saturday once more, and I'm back this time with a little serious topic, a topic which is a little different, no doubt, but an essential part of life, that is emotional abuse. Let's first be a little clear about what we mean by abuse. In very layman's terms, in very general, I'm not going by dictionary definitions, abuse is when one person or persons takes advantage of the others because of vulnerability or because of surrender or because of whatever the means. So if I, because of my dominating position, either it could be my physical, power or my money power or my position or my relationship to the victim, if I start taking advantage of the other person, then what am I doing to the other person? I am abusing the other person. That's how we would like to understand in general what abuse means. Now, specifically, what are the types of abuse? Let's take, for example, verbal abuse. That means that I say things which hurt the other person. I put down that person. I ridicule that person. I say bad things about that person. I try to, push that person down psychologically by using words and sentences and statements which hurt the other person, which pull down the person's self-esteem, which makes the person feel miserable and vulnerable. So one is abuse by the use of words. At the same time, let us also understand that there's another form of abuse which is not very well understood, and that is clandestine abuse. That means going behind the back and doing something. So you have people who don't shout or hit or do anything physical, but they abuse by sarcasm. They abuse by depriving the other person of what the other person needs. They abuse by spreading gossip about that person. So that's why we call it clandestine. It's not a direct. You see, if somebody comes and shouts at me or says some horrible things to me, then I can retaliate. But if the other person is doing it in a very, very, roundabout manner, then I will never come to know. So there are people, who apparently are praising somebody, but roundabout way, they are putting that person down, and the person doesn't even at times realize what is happening to that person. It could be something like, if somebody asks me, do you know Mr. X? And I say, yes. So can you tell me something about him? And I say, oh, you want me to tell about X? You really want me to tell about X? I don't know what to say. No, it's better I don't say anything. Now, have I abused X? Have I said anything wrong about him? No, not at all. I can swear and say I did not utter a word putting the other person down. But what is the impact on the receiver? When I said, I'd rather not say anything about X, what is the indication that I have given that X is so bad that I can't think of anything good about him, and therefore I just don't want to comment about him? So the various ways and means by which clandestine abuse takes place. Then we move on to physical abuse. Actually hitting a person, causing physical damage to that person in various ways and forms. And perhaps the most cruel is what we refer to as sexual abuse, right? So these are the range of abuses. Before I go into the details of it, let me also tell you that abuse does not take place only by bad people who hate the victim or who want to put down the victim. Let's be aware of the fact that sometimes abuse takes place with good intentioned people, starting with parents to children. If I am making comments about my child, thinking that only if I make him aware of what he is doing wrong or where he is missing out, then he will learn how to improve himself. But if I am not careful, I may be actually causing damage to the child. So I can do verbal abuse by saying, look at your sister, how well she studies, how everybody appreciates her, she is doing so well. What's wrong with you? You are intelligent. You have the capacity and yet you don't want to study. Now what am I doing? I'm praising my child. I'm saying you are intelligent. You have the capacity. But actually speaking, I am verbally abusing my child. I may even make statements like, you will never improve. You just don't have that desire in you. No? What's the point? I don't even want to waste time in, you know, scolding you or putting you down, because I know you're just not going to do it. Now again, what am I doing? I am pulling down the self-esteem of the child. I'm making the person feel that you are worthless. Parents do it too. Children, bosses do it to subordinates. So many people do it in so many different ways. Same thing with physical abuse. There are people who think that unless I use physical force, this person will not improve. So I have to be strict. I have to use physical force. I'm doing it with good intention. I want that person to improve and to change. But the effect can be exactly the opposite. I was just reading up a manual on jail rules, regulations, and how jail administration should be. Now look at prisons anywhere. Physical abuse is used to so-called reform a criminal. But you and I are very, very aware of the fact that a petty thief goes into prison and comes out as a hardened criminal. Because we tried to use physical force against him and he realizes that the only way to get along in this world and to succeed and to survive is to use back physical force. And of course, sexual abuse, which again, as I said, can be sometimes with good intention. It could be a husband, you know, sexually abusing his own wife. There's nothing to prevent him from abusing his wife sexually, but it can have a tremendous impact on the person concerned. So this way, let us understand that there is a range of ways in which abuse takes place. But today, what we are going to discuss is the emotional impact. The impact on the mind, not on the body. There are children who are hit black and blue and they laugh. And they say, okay, you want to hit me? You go ahead and hit me. What will you do to me? I don't care. I still remember an old friend of mine who used to recall saying that he used to stay in a boarding where the teachers used to be very strict. He said, whenever I knew that I have done something wrong and I'm going to be caned, they used to cane, you know, children on their bottoms. So he says, whenever I knew that I'm going to get a caning, I used to wear 3 underwears, one above the other, and then wear the uniform and go there. And here is this teacher hitting away at my bottom and nothing would happen to me. So you see, what happened? Physically, abuse is taking place. But emotionally, nothing is affecting the so-called victim. So in many ways, verbal abuse, even sexual abuse for that matter. I know of people who have survived sexual abuse by literally pitying the abuser and saying that, what a nasty, you know, good-for-nothing fellow. What a horrible fellow, you know. He takes advantage of children and he does this horrible thing. And I was also one of the victims and I suffered under him. But now I know what it is. I protect myself and I don't know where he is or what he's doing. Or even if I know, I don't care. But I am out of it and I move on with life. If anything, I will help other children to protect themselves against such people. But in those cases where the abuse becomes emotional, where it impacts the mind, that is where we need to understand what happens. There are a lot of sensitive people who, when the abuse takes place, it has a long-term impact. Sometimes it has a lifelong impact. Now that is our area of concern. Recently, I was talking to the daughter of a student of mine. Her name is Kushi. Kushi, as you know, means happiness. Very happy child, grown-up child. She's going to college. In fact, she's studying psychology now. And when we were having a discussion, since she is herself a budding psychologist, we were having this discussion on how, you know, the emotional impact can be when a person is abused in childhood or in the growing formative years. She agreed, she's a very courageous child, I must say. She agreed to say that, okay, I don't mind coming on camera and, you know, explaining how this happens and what happened to me and what is the impact of the thing. So let's hear Kushi.
And I have personally experienced emotional abuse and manipulation by a very close person. And the unfortunate truth is that the closer the person is to you, the impact of the abuse is even more. But since I've been an abuser, have been experiencing this since I was a small kid, it's going to take a lot more energy for me to heal myself. But now that I realize it and I'm ready to work for it, it's actually a little more empowering to know that I can personally put in the effort and actively make changes to my life, make it better. Even though I may not have gotten optimal care and love as a kid, knowing that I can give it to myself now is the biggest tool I can have.
Wonderful, Vishay. As I said, no, number one, it takes a lot of courage to share. And number two, you see what she did? She's accepted and admitted that the closer the person is, the abuser to you, the greater is the impact. If a stranger hits me or says very nasty things to me, I can get over it. But if it is somebody whom I love or I regard or I respect, and that person abuses me in whatever form, need not, as I said, be sexual or physical. But if I get abused by somebody whom I trust, whom I look up to, and who I expect will protect me and encourage me and empower me, but this person is doing exactly the opposite. This person is putting me down. Now, as I was telling you a while back, that some very, very balanced and mature people, as they grow up, they realize what has happened to them. And like Kushi said, I convert that into my strength to be able to understand life at its barest. So there are people who go through very bad experiences, get very disturbed emotionally, but use it as a means to overcome that. Now that I know that this has happened, it's like, you know, I keep walking on a road and I have fallen down. Now I become more careful and I say, I know where I fall down. I know what are the dangers which make me fall down. So even though I'm hurt, I'm thankful to the fall, because now I'll be so careful that I will never fall again. Now, those who do not manage to do what people like Kushi did, they feel humiliated. Their self-esteem goes down. They start feeling miserable. They feel that the world is ignoring them. Even if somebody praises them, they wonder, is this person being sarcastic? Is this person just trying to flatter me? Can it really be true that this person is being nice to me? And reverse of that, you've all been hearing of late the word called gaslighting. Gaslighting is one of the, you know, very subtle ways of emotional abuse, by making the victim think that you are at fault. The classic example of that was when a husband told the wife, why do you make me hit you? Why do you provoke me so much? Now we know what is happening in the mind, but it is so, you know, true that over a period of time, when that happens, the wife actually over a period of time starts believing that, yes, there is something wrong with me. Maybe I am provoking him. Maybe I is the one who have to need to change myself. Anyway, the other factor that comes out of emotional abuse is that often there are no visible marks. You see, if A hits B and if there is a mark on B's body, then B can tell everybody with evidence that he hit. But when the hit is on your mind and your heart, how do you show to other people? So there are all these people who go ahead with emotional abuse and get away with it because quite often they do not believe the victim. And the victim is not as crafty as the abuser. The victim tells also in very subtle, very innocent ways, whereas the abuser protects himself or herself through very crafty means. The other aspect of emotional abuse is more often than not, it happens behind closed doors. And people don't come to know what is happening. Once the door is open, it looks as though everybody is fine and happy and all that. One of the biggest aspects of this was during the lockdown for COVID. Many people said, I got closer to my family because we were together 24/7. I could bond better. I could understand better. We did so many activities together. We feel now, you know, that we love each other more. Yes, it did happen. But that is not to deny that in many other families, the reverse happened. People took advantage. Because of their frustration, they couldn't get out. They took out their anger on their loved ones. There are so many instances of people who are dependent on, let's say, alcohol. When they could not get alcohol because of the lockdown, they took out their frustration on their loved ones. Maybe they didn't hit them. So nobody can say that this person has been, you know, abusive in the traditional sense of the word. But the person may have said the nastiest of things. The person may have actually blamed the victim for something which he or she had never done. And because of that, not only in COVID times, but in many other instances, many a time, a counselee who has been abused by her husband or partner or boyfriend or whatever it is, when they share, they actually say that it is not the impact of any physical abuse or even sexual abuse, which is bad. It is the impact of the emotional abuse. That hits me very badly and I am not able to overcome that. Sometimes they don't even want to talk about it. They don't want to tell anybody. Like I told you, if it is physical abuse, they can show evidence and say, see, this person has hit me like this. But if it is verbal, emotional, the person feels, what's the point in telling everybody? The person suffers in silence. And if the abuser happens to be a person who is good to everybody else, people don't even believe if the victim says that this person is so horrible and treating me in such a bad manner. So what is the long-term impact and what can we do about it is what we need to discuss. As I mentioned earlier, it could lead to loss of self-esteem, bad relationships with others, developing pessimism and negativity, going into depression, and in extreme cases, what we refer to as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. People sometimes succumb to a disorder called PTSD, where they continue to suffer and they continue to go through a bad time even after the abuse is over. Similarly, let us not neglect the fact that emotional abuse can also have an impact on the body physically. There are people who develop palpitations. They develop severe anxiety. They go into panic attacks. There are people who develop insomnia. Their sleep is gone. They just can't sleep. And please keep in mind that if you lose your sleep on a continuous basis, it can impact every other aspect of your life. Your work, your relationships, your cognitive abilities, your, you know, ability to emote with people, all that goes down if you suffer from insomnia. Insomnia is continuous inability to sleep at least that minimum time that every human being needs. In severe cases, I have come across people suffering from things like ulcers, digestive problems, because they were victims of abuse. Okay. Now, the point is that the person may be criticizing the victim, shaming the victim, creating guilt, which is what we refer to as, gaslighting. Another thing that happens is that the victim at times surrenders and thereby abuses himself or herself more. That this is what I deserve. I am bad. I don't deserve anything good. Self-esteem goes down. So many children, so many grown-up women, so many men also, they feel that I am worthless because I have been told 100 times that I am worthless. The main thing is that this is an area which has not been given enough importance to. You would come across a lot of people giving sex education to children to prevent sexual abuse. We have all this POXO and POSH and all these acts by which, you know, people are prevented from being physically abused or sexually abused. But emotional abuse is very, very, very less understood and therefore less treated. If it is not acknowledged, it is not understood, either the victim himself or herself does not know, or when the victim shares with somebody in confidence, somebody whom the victim trusts, the other person doesn't know what to do. If it is physical, the person can say, okay, shall I go and beat up this guy who's been beating you? But what do you do with the person who has left a tremendous emotional impact on you, like I mentioned over here? So let me also give you a few very practical but very useful tips on how you can overcome the effects of emotional abuse. Obviously, it starts with recognizing it. Identifying that, yes, it is emotional abuse. Many a time I've heard victims saying, no, he has never hit me. No, he has never been physically abusive with me. He need not be. The impact can be as much or even worse when there is emotional abuse. So recognize it, identify it, and analyze rationally. Okay, here and there a little bit I may have contributed, but overall, if you see, I am the victim and this person is the abuser. Let's be very clear on that. Just because you were very innocent, you were very non-violent, you were very submissive, you allowed that emotional abuse to continue on a long-term basis. Once you have accepted that you are a victim, you need to sort of make a resolution. What happened in the past, I will not now allow myself to be abused. That's the first thing to do. Protect myself. I am not going to accept if this abuser starts saying things or uses ways and means to put me down. I am no longer going to accept that. How? We will see as we go along. But you should make a resolution that from victim, I am now going to become what we call as a survivor. I am going to be a survivor, like a person develops, a serious ailment. So people say, this person is a cancer patient going through cancer, which is a disease. But one fine day, that person can become a cancer survivor. I have survived cancer. I have done whatever treatment, therapy, this. And today I can say that I am a healed person. And in fact, I am a better person today for having gone through cancer, because it has taught me certain lessons of life, made me sit up and think, which I would not have normally done. So when you tell yourself that from abuse victim, I'm now going to be an abuse survivor. You can start thinking rationally and you can start thinking what happened, why it happened. If there was a contribution from my part, how much was that contribution? And what are the lessons that I have learned from this abuse? Any negative experience that a human being goes through can be converted into a lesson and a stepping stone if you have that attitude. Like they say, failures are the stepping stones to success. Somebody fails in an exam or in achieving something or doesn't get a promotion or doesn't get whatever it is, doesn't get somebody whom he loves and he doesn't get that person in his life or whatever. We call these failures, right? But as we understand, failures are very often stepping stones to success if we take it in that manner. The one area to be careful of is not to get into confrontations, arguments, accusations. Most abusers, particularly the subtle abusers who do it in clandestine way, who do it in a very, you know, off-guarded way, they know how to get their way around. So I would recommend, don't waste your time getting into this verbal battles with this person or making accusations or saying you are an abuser. Very, very rare cases I found where a person actually admits that, yes, I am an abuser, particularly if the person has not been physically abusive. So don't even attempt it. What has happened, you can't turn the clock back. You can't suddenly feel very nice and happy just because the person said, oh, is it? Yeah, I did this bad thing. I shouldn't have done it. I'm so sorry. No, it doesn't help. What does help is to minimize the impact, to maintain your distance, to protect yourself. If required, even protect your loved ones who are possible victims of the same abuser. And that is where you build that team of people who decide that we are going to be survivors. Once you do that, you move on to the final step, that is coping skills. What are the ways and means in which I can cope with whatever has happened to me? Now here, there is no, you know, one solution that fits all. It depends on the intensity of the abuse. It depends on the intensity of the impact that it has left on the victim. It depends on how long that abuse went on and what needs to be done at this juncture. It depends on what's the continuing relationship with that abuser today. All these factors have to be taken into account. But as we have been talking and discussing, whenever something like this happens, there are definitely ways and means. If you can think of ways and means by yourself, nothing like it. You'll be able to look back with pride and say, yes, I was a victim. I suffered for a long time, but eventually I not only came out of it, but I have converted myself into a survivor by learning certain lessons and improving my quality of life. If you're not in a position to do that, then seek help. There's nothing wrong in seeking help. The sad part is that every time a person gets, let's say, an illness or an accident or something, we rush to take help. But when it comes to something to do with the mind, we hesitate. My request to all of you, and spread this message to all your friends and acquaintances, please do not hesitate to seek help. You can get help if you are willing to work on it, okay? With that, I'll take my 1 minute break and I shall come back. Sonal is here to just update you on what's happening and I will see you in a couple of minutes.
I am Archana and I have been associated with Banjara Academy as a counselor, as a trainer, as a faculty, as a mentor for their CCAT course. CCAT has been specially close to my heart because I got to learn a lot. Though I am not CCAT certified, but I take pride in being a mentor for many batches and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. The speciality of CCAT course is that you get to experience, you know, learn it hands-on experience, not only by observing your own children, but observing other children. And the best part about this is, it's not only understanding about children or, you know, adolescents, it's also understanding about your own self that you undergo, you take this journey as. So your mentor will be helping you. Like me, there are many other mentors, and that's the specialty of this course. You get to enjoy through a lot of activities, and the activities are very, very relatable to your own life and to the kids around. So wishing you all the best.
So yes, that is certificate in child and adolescent development. And Archana was one of the mentor of one of the batches. And that's what she has shared in the video, that mentoring is the specialty of the course. Though the CCAD course is online, you will see videos on our website, LMS system. But through the video learning, certain churning of mind happens, or certain observations that you had, or certain situations either you have observed with yourself or happening with someone, that churns your mind and you think about it, and you have certain way that you have perceived it, and you want to talk it out to someone who can understand that and can give you a different perspective. Now that is what a mentor of CCAD course will be doing with you. And it will be a team of the people who have chosen to do the course, and the common purpose will be to understand children. That's what is the course all about, certificated child and adolescent development. Now, what makes the mentoring unique is, as I told, when you watch the lessons and you have certain questions, you will be discussing it out, and or not only questions, even your perception, what you have perceived. In the team, there are 10 of them. And each one will have a different perception to a certain situations. So you get to know how you learn from each other, along with what you learn from the lessons that come to you, right? This is one part. Apart from that, any of the in-house faculties, means the Banjara faculties, also will be part of the mentoring group as and when certain topics are there. We have certain specialists over here. So who will join the mentoring group in between whenever those specific topics are there, right? So that's how the mentoring group is, like, not only based on what I thought, but also what others are giving, and faculty input also, along with the videos and the notes and everything. You get so much of personal touch to the whole course and the situations, and you can even discuss it out, so many different things. And CCAD also helps you to understand a child right from the conceiving stage of the mother. What all effects can happen? How the emotional state of the mother can affect a child while growing? How the environment, even though if we think that, no, I am, you know, making sure everything is peaceful at home, I make sure my child doesn't witness everything, but yet how it affects a child. All those different aspects are very openly spoken, discussed, I would say demystified rather, in CCAD. That's what I can tell in this 1 or 2 minutes. More, if you want, you can get in touch with our office. 28th is the inaugural class. If you wish to join that class and then make a decision also is fine. So whoever is here today, and if you think that this course can help someone, please forward them this information, or they can call up our office number, speak to Anise. She will help you out in all the aspects. Yeah, that's from me. Have a great weekend, everyone.
Yes, I'm back, and the festive season is just getting on. We are going to have a nice long weekend with the Dasara. So let's do some serious thinking on these issues. And I can already see a lot of very, very relevant questions and comments. Let's start off with Surekha as usual, who always has something meaningful to add to every topic that we have been discussing. Surekha says, how can we distance from a person emotionally, especially when our thoughts become obsessive and compulsive about that person? In fact, Surekha has given a very nice suggestion about having an entire session, one of these Saturday sessions, on maintaining that emotional distance or building up that emotional distance. I'm going to take it up in a serious manner and in depth. So I can't just quickly in 1 minute answer how do we, maintain that emotional distance. There are various ways and means. So I've already taken Surekha's suggestion and I'm working on it. When we come to that day, when we are going to have that topic, we'll go through in detail. Asha says, abuse can be take up in many ways. I've come across people who will smilingly emotional misuse, but by the time they understand, a lot of damage is done. Exactly, Asha. This is what I mentioned as clandestine abuse, hidden abuse, roundabout, abuse. In Hindi, they used to say, kambal mein lapet ke marna. You know, as though you are protecting the person by putting a shawl around him and then you are hitting the person. So there are so many ways in which people, for whatever their reason, it's very difficult to psychoanalyze abusers. They are such a wide range, I tell you. In all my years of experience, I have seen the entire gamut of abusers and I've come to the conclusion that there is no fixed profile of an abuser. That this type of people or this category of people or people of this background, nothing like that. So let us not talk about the abuser. Let us talk about the victim and how the victim can be converted into a survivor. Because very often survivors, have learned lessons of life which make their own life enriched and they lead a better quality of life, which they would have not had if they had been, abused. But I do take Asha's point very seriously, that is identify, that is what I said. The moment you get this uneasy feeling that this person is praising me, this person is being nice to me, but is there some wrong intention in this person? Is this person trying to be sarcastic? Is this person trying to hide something? Is this person saying something in my presence and something else in my absence? You should start becoming aware that that person can cause you emotional abuse. Veena says, how to counsel the person who had not come out of emotional abuse even after 30 years? Good you brought up this point, Veena. This emphasizes the fact that issues which are to do with the mind and issues which affect the mind to a great deal do not heal by themselves. There's a proverb which says, time is the best healer. It applies only to minor wounds. Take physical wounds, for example. If I just cut my hand a little bit, I don't do anything. I just leave my hand as it is. You will notice that after some time, a blood clot forms, the bleeding stops. After some time, that blood clot also matures and falls off. And there it is, my hand is back to normal. So time is the best healer. But supposing the cut is so deep that a vein has been cut and I'm bleeding. And if I keep looking at my hand and say, yeah, time is the best healer, it will happen. No, I'll bleed myself to death. The same thing applies to the mind. So if the person is doing something in a very clandestine and a hidden manner, becoming aware of it is your first step to trying to, overcome it, heal it, and moving on. Veena also says there is impact on her health, insomnia. That's what I mentioned some time back, no? That there can be so many aspects, physical, mental, emotional. And if, as Veena just now told us, 30 years the person has gone through, and yet the person has not moved from being a victim to a survivor, that person is the same way as you were to come across a patient who has been sick for 30 years. You will say it's not just some, you know, go to some ordinary doctor and get some, you know, medicines or something. No, you have to go right into the depth of that 30 years of, you know, illness that that person has gone through. And then only you, the doctor will be able to prescribe the right remedy. The same thing applies to mental health issues. This person, if he or she is willing, needs to go through in-depth, you know, catharsis, therapy, whatever you want to call it. And it is very, very individual. I cannot just give you one simple answer to it, right? Surekha says, emotional distancing is painful. Change is painful. But nothing is as painful as staying stuck somewhere where you don't feel respected. That is very, very true, Surekha. When a person feels stuck, and I have come across, unfortunately, many, many people who are stuck. And these people, that's what I said, no, when they surrender, they are actually abusing themselves. When they say, I can't do anything about it, it's not in my hands. If I do, these things become worse. No, they don't. Initially, yes. For some time, yes. If you try to unstick yourself, you may be subjected to further abuse. You may have to go through a lot of ups and downs. But take it from me, in the long run, you will move on to a better quality of life. Vinita says, actually, Ali, sometimes emotional abuse starts very early and before we realize damage has already happened. Most of them just don't say anything because unfortunately it comes from our families. That's exactly what I said a few minutes back also, that the closer the relationship, the greater is the emotional impact. If a distant relative of mine makes some nasty comments about me and goes on making nasty comments, it's easier to take it. But if my own sibling says it, it is more difficult. If my parent says it is more difficult. If my child says it is more difficult. If my spouse says it is extremely difficult. So we have to understand, however much we may love, respect, care for our close relationships, we should become aware when emotional abuse is taking place. Satish says, good afternoon, Ali. I was also a victim of emotional abuse. Thanks to Ali and the entire Banjara team, I can proudly confess, because you all, I could overcome the abuse and I'm slowly getting back my self-esteem, if not fully. Many thanks. And thank you very much, Satish, for having the courage to, you know, come on board and say it. It is not whether Ali has done it or Team Banjara has done it. You have worked for it. We were the catalysts, yes. We are catalysts to so many people, but unless and until you have that desire, you have that, you know, willpower and that consistency to say that I will come out of it. And like Satish says, it will never come back to 100%. If your self-esteem from 100 has gone down to 30, if from 30 you can make it 40, 50, 60, 70, be happy. Don't aim for 100%. Don't aim for anything perfect. Surekha also says, how can you care for others if you cannot even care for yourself? How can you do good if you don't feel good? This is a very, very long controversy, Surekha. In fact, when I first got into counseling almost 4 decades back, I was told by many eminent people that if you have emotional issues, you cannot help anybody else in emotional issues. It's like telling a doctor that if you have stomachache, you cannot cure somebody else's stomachache. If you have broken a bone, you cannot help somebody else to heal their broken bones. It doesn't happen that way. In fact, in many cases I have seen, people who have actually gone through such, you know, difficult experiences, they are more sensitive, more empathic, more capable of helping others. Srikha also says, regardless of how they abuse you, tolerance is how you abuse yourself. Very well said, Srikha. we need to cultivate the fine skills of emotional distancing, and I will add, protecting yourself, loving yourself, giving yourself some nice, warm, positive strokes, doing some gestures to reinforce to yourself that, yes, I'm a good human being. I'm a capable human being. I have my flaws. I'm not perfect. I have made mistakes. At times, I've also hurt others. But overall, I'm a good human being, and I don't deserve to be abused by this person so badly. I will not allow this to continue indefinitely. Dr. Shirin has come in. Welcome, Shirin. And she says, if the parent is trying to be strict, is harsh towards a teenage child, how can the child be protected? Because he, she doesn't know how to protect itself. Very true. And that is why many, many people in their formative years suffer this emotional abuse, and it has this long-term impact. So if you have access to this teenager, you can put in your own little bit by, you know, turning the tables around. Where, let's say, a parent is saying, you are good for nothing. You are not studying well. You can counterbalance that by saying, hey, I saw that in English language, you got such high marks. Maybe tomorrow you'll become, go into mass communication or literature or education or something, and you'll do well. Not many people. Yeah, there are people who do much better than you in maths or science or other subjects. But you have done very well in this. So pick out the positives of that person and keep giving it. You cannot undo what is happening because it's the child's own parent. You can't take away the child from the parent. But you can counterbalance it by go on giving positive strokes, positive reinforcements, and helping the child to think better about himself or herself. Surekha says, when we don't distance from negative people, life can get very frustrating. Agreed, agreed, absolutely. It's like running up on roller skates. Very true. But all I would say is, it is difficult. It is very, very difficult, but it is not impossible. And we should not give up trying. Veena says, many, many times of catharsis is over, but it still goes on. No, Veena, here I want to point out that possibly the catharsis is not over. Catharsis is not something which can be measured, that, okay, once I sit down and talk, catharsis is over. Or no, six times I have sessions with somebody and I go on and on pouring out, now catharsis is over. Sometimes the catharsis takes much longer. And you know, the duration of the catharsis depends on the therapist or the person or the counselor who is making the victim go through the catharsis. The more subtly you are showing your acceptance, you're being a better listener, you're doing supportive listening, you're giving small little positives there, you're empathizing with the person, then the catharsis gets over. Just because a person has had six sessions with a therapist of 1 hour each and recounted everything that has happened about the abuse, that does not mean that catharsis is over. Like in any other treatment or any other healing, here also it is the quality of the catharsis which the therapist or the counselor is taking the person through. Vinita says, sometimes, Ali, some people intentionally do it repeatedly and it's very difficult to understand what pleasure they achieve. Yes, just a few minutes back, that's what I was saying. No? That is very difficult to define what goes on in the mind of the abuser. There's such a wide variety of them, why they do it, how they do it. I can spend hours describing to you the mind and the thinking of so many different abusers, but does it help? Does it give relief? No, it doesn't. So that is why I would say, keep the abuser aside. Have pity on him. Say, what a horrible fellow that he can't even control his life. He goes about trying to make life miserable for others instead of enriching his or her own life. And move on to the victim, converting the victim into a survivor. Kanaka says, it's a common dialogue by any mother saying to her naughty child that why do you make me take the sick? How do you deal in that situation? The child also should be given punishment sometimes. Agreed, Kanka, but there is a thing called constructive punishment. The stick is definitely not a constructive punishment. Long back, there was a proverb which said, spare the rod and spoil the child. Meaning to say, if you don't take the rod or the stick and hit, you're spoiling the child. That's what our ancestors used to say. I don't know, maybe it was relevant at that time, but it is definitely not relevant today. Today, what we call as capital punishment, using the stick or using even your hand for that matter, has proven that it is contraindicated. It can make matters worse. The child or whoever is the victim feels, I may have done something bad. Okay, I admit that I've done something bad. Now, you did something bad by hitting me, right? So I have paid the price for it. Now I don't owe you anything. I don't feel guilty anymore. And now I will do what I want, including the naughty things that I did earlier for which I was punished. Madhu says, yes, I agree. I have been going through this process. It was like living like a dead person. Yes, Madhu, I truly understand how these things happen. You go numb, you know, it's literally like you are a dead person. You lose all your motivation, your enthusiasm and all that. But Madhu says, at last, I became courageous and took a decision to be strong. This is what some of our people, right from the youngster Kushi who spoke to us a little earlier, to what Madhu shared just now. Take a courageous decision, take a brave decision and move on. Madhu also said, now my happiness and peace comes first. No more emotional blackmail. Yes, that is where you need to love yourself and say, my happiness and peace is as important as the happiness and peace of my loved ones or of others. And I will not give up on that. It was a very, very, very painful process, Madhu says, and I agree with you. I can visualize how painful it must have been. At the same time, I not only visualize, but acknowledge and congratulate so many people like Madhu who have had that courage and moved on. As she's saying, no one was there, I had to handle it alone. That's the funny part of abuse, you know. If you become a victim, and you don't fight for your rights and you start succumbing to it, or even if you're fighting for your rights for that matter, very few people stand by you. It is that NIMBY syndrome, you know, not in my backyard. I have nothing to do with it, so I will not take sides. Yeah, I do understand that one person is the victim, the other is the abuser, but let them handle it. And more so when it is close people. They say, yeah, after all, they are related, they are so close, they are family, they are whatever. Husband and wife or whatever it is. So who am I to interfere? I don't want to interfere. And if I go and show sympathy to one person, the other person will get angry with me. So best thing to do is to keep away. So abuse, victims of abuse find themselves isolated many a time. But let me also tell you, if you look for that one or two people who have that courage and who have that concern and love and affection towards you, if they stand by you, it is more than enough. And if you seek counseling, the counselor who is going to give you unconditional support and concern and love, that is the person who will start the process of reversing whatever your, you know, self-esteem and everything that has been battered. Asha says, actually, we feel light when we take action against the abuser in whatever way possible. Yes. Once you start doing it, initially you yourself may be scared. You may say, what will happen? I don't know what will happen. But once you start taking that step, and most abusers, you know, are basically cowards. Just because the victim is not, you know, saying something back, that is why they continue. It is like that street dog who suddenly starts barking at anybody who is going past. Any person turns to the street dog and lifts up a stone or a stick or something like that, you see how he runs. He doesn't have that courage. He's just thinking that these people will keep going past. They will be scared of me, so I will keep barking. This is how abusers are. Madhu says, now I focus on unclutching and completion with others and keep life and respect for myself. Yes, Madhu, hearty congratulations for the way you have gone through in your journey of life. You are a wonderful role model to so many others and inspiration to so many others. Rachel says, when one is emotionally abused by their parent, the parent who has been through emotional abuse themselves, the guilt they feel to even admit that the parent is wrong is immense. How do you suggest that you deal with it? When I come across such a person, you see, the victim will start off by saying what the parent has done and will immediately go into a denial mode saying, no, but my mother loves me very much. My father, you know, he'll take so much care of me. You know, my father is a wonderful person. You know, my mother is this. I hear them out and then I say, nobody is passing judgment on your mother or your father. Nobody is saying that your parent is a bad person. We are only focusing on the impact of certain behaviors of theirs which has happened to you. We are only concerned about that. And to be able to heal yourself, you have to accept that certain behavior of your loved one, your own parent, your own whoever it is, has impacted you. So let us acknowledge them that, okay, they were primarily good parents. They loved you. They wanted the best for you, and keep them aside. But the actions or the words or whatever they did, which has left an impact on you, we have to work on it without becoming defensive about the parents. Okay, Parveen says, abuse thrives in secrecy. Yes, that's what I mentioned, no? Behind closed doors. The day you bring it out in the open, the abuser will stop mostly. Yes. And here I would also like to add that unfortunately, there are many victims who indirectly encourage the abuser by hiding, by keeping the door closed. Even if somebody asks that something bad happened, no, nothing like that happened. Yes, we are coming to the end of the hour. Anita says, emotional abuse, I've read, is also one stage in the cycle of physical abuse in domestic abuse situations. How can one gauge the red flags, whether it's just emotional or has the potential to become physical? Understand, Anita, that physical can be emotional. Emotional can be emotional. Physical can be physical. So we are not differentiating and saying this is physical abuse and this is emotional abuse. What we are discussing today is the impact, the emotional impact on verbal abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, clandestine abuse. So it is up to us to say, start with your own feelings. If you are a victim, you will identify and recognize that I am not feeling up to it. I'm feeling bad. There's something in this relationship which is putting me off. I'm feeling very upset about whatever is happening to me. And if that continues for some time, have the courage to accept it, that you are being victimized by the abuser, however close and however loved that abuser is, and start working on it at the earliest. As I told you earlier, it could be, if you can do it, nothing like it. There are people like Madhu who have done a lot by themselves. Some Ali, some Banjara, somebody may have helped those people to some extent, but they have taken the cudgels and they have come out with it. And there are some who feel, yes, I want to, but I really don't know how. I don't have that motivation. I don't have that mental strength to do it. In those cases, seek counseling. There's absolutely nothing wrong. Of late, we are also hearing a lot about counseling and therapy having become very expensive. Please remember that there are people like Banjara Academy who do not charge a single rupee for counseling. We are not the only ones. There are people who are not looking at therapy or counseling as a means to make money. So you can look at somebody like that. You can find somebody and you can heal yourself. So go ahead and do whatever best you can to heal yourself. I will sign off by wishing all of you a very, very happy Dasara and have a wonderful long weekend. We shall meet next Saturday, which is on 28th of October at the same time, that is 2:00, with this very interesting topic called undefined relationships, relationships which do not have a label. father, mother, boss, neighbor, classmate, and all that. So undefined relationships, what they mean and what they are to us, how they govern our life. Thank you and bye-bye.
And I have personally experienced emotion abuse and manipulation by a very close person. And the unfortunate truth is that the closer the person is to you, the impact of the abuse is even more. But since I've been an abuser, have been experiencing this since I was a small kid, it's going to take a lot more energy for me to heal myself. But now that I realize it, and I'm ready to work for it, it's actually a little more empowering to know that I can personally put in the effort and actively make changes to my life, make it better. Even though I may not have gotten optimal care and love as a kid, knowing that I can give it to myself now is the biggest tool I can have.